all the Varian rules of Eastern Imperial Highway.
Huh?
Yeah. Yeah.
And the most important thing that decisive battles fought along the Southern Ganges route, it shows the importance of the Southern Ganges route, that is the Eastern Imperial Highway of the Mughal period. We can see the series of battle took place there. Battle of Surajgarh in 1534, that is between Munger and Patna. Battle of Chausa, where Humayun was defeated, that is also along the Eastern Imperial Highway. Then second battle of Surajgarh took place in 1557 between Muhammad Shah Adil and the Bengal Sultan Bahadur Shah. And battle of Tukarwai, battle of Rajmahal, these are all decisive battles. Then there was the Jharkhand route also. Jharkhand route was not there. There was no highway before 1763. But after 1763, we can see there are the two highways were developed. One was the new military road in the 1785 to 1830 by the British East India Company. In that route, Hajaribagh was the important town. And secondly, Grand Trunk Road was developed in 1832 onwards. So Grand Trunk Road connecting with Calcutta to Sherghati to Usasara. That is the one of the new alignment done across Jharkhand, that is the second route. So this is the Mughal and colonial highways of Eastern India. In the red line, that is the actual Eastern Imperial Highway, which Sher Shah actually built up. Sher Shah had no relation with Calcutta, hence Grand Trunk Road, it was built by English East India Company. That was the second route across Jharkhand, and the first route was the new military road.
Please come.
So indeed, right? Thanks.
So, we have a lot of time, but it is all in problem. Otherwise, we will be very happy to listen to papers like this for a longer time, because it will be beneficial for youngsters, even. But then, you also understand the constraint that we have. We have plenty of papers, and everybody should have a chance, because it is only one way that we get. Otherwise, Vishwas cannot be stopped, and we can go on for some more time also.
It is very interesting.
Notwithstanding the kind of interest that it evokes us, this also should have the chance. So, it is so explicit, I think there are no doubts over it. We will move on to the other paper. The other paper will be...
Sir, page 28.
Page number 28.
Okay, I think it doesn't let on.
Good morning. My paper is an interesting unpublished copper plate inscription of Raja Pritam Singh of Kullu. There are not many copper plate inscriptions that have survived from the former kingdom of Kullu. Some of them are known since the completions of Hutchison and Bogar, history of the Bijar peoples. In a recent study, many Mughal inscriptions from Kullu have been studied, but the non-copper plates have not been totally deciphered and studied. One such copper plate is briefly mentioned by Hiranand and Hutchison and Bogar. Till now, the whereabouts of the copper plate was unknown. The copper plate is in the possessions of the Kartar of the Muritha temple at Dhawasana. It is inscribed in Taki script, and the language used is the Kulvi, a dialect of the Western Kartar. The translation is called the Great King of Kings, the Sovereign King, the Holy One, Vaishnathas, son, Shri Ramchandra's servant, Pritam Singh has donated villages to God Muridhara of Thawa as per ancient authoritative custom. Among the two villages are named Chandi and Adaro, situated before Nagar. Donated villages include Bhatna, which is situated before Mandalgarh. If anyone from Jagat Singh's family is suspicious about it or the granted villages to Muridhara, it would be a victory towards Chiri Muridhara. These villages had borne the expenses of Shri Muridhara since long. Now these expenses would be continued to be borne as per earlier original and authoritative custom. It is certified if the Kamdara spent the income from on their own benefits. They would be wishing that God would have as well as the king of Ulu. If there would be an increase in the offering of the temple inadvertently, in that case it would be considered the mistake of the Bhandari. The offerings could be taken by the Kamdara, Bhata Pujari and Panditas. All the utensils used and unused had to be cleaned. If any utensil is lost, the Kamdara and Bhata Pujari and water carriers would be considered as retained. The auspicious king came personally to Dhawa village and guaranteed these villages. Written in the summer 56, Matsar Pravishti 12, equivalent to the AD 1780 in the month of March. Granted to Sri Muralidhara for auspicious of Dharma. It is clearly known from the above translation that Dashratha bears the title Sri Maharshri Param Bhattarak, Sri Maharaja Dhiraj, Sri Maharaja and Raja Pritam Singh is simply referred to as a Gulam of Rama. In this thank you.
Nice. So, any question on this? Presentation. Nice. Thank you very much.
Oh, no. Take the. No, we have
to take this. So, basically, we will announce his name as well as.
Hello, good morning. I will summarize within 2 or 3 minutes my paper.
Yes,
there is a few emergency. The title of my paper is Either to Unpublished Copper Plates on Inscription of Raja Pritam Singh of Chamba, Himachal Pradesh. I will divide it, my presentation in 3 parts. First one will be introduction of the copper plates in the term of Indian history and copper plate discussion about the term of Western Himalaya, and lastly I will go on my conclusion session. Among the metals, the copper was the most common writing material in the ancient and medieval time in India. Similarly, by so far, the copper plate was the most common metal used in the inscriptions. When we studied the copper plate inscription of the Western Himalayan region, the large number of copper plate inscriptions are found in Chamba region. Eminent scholar and archaeologist J.J. Fogel, in his course of his research, has been able to collect 82 copper plate inscriptions, of which 5 belong to pre-Muslim and 77 from medieval period. Fogel deciphered and documented earlier copper plate inscriptions, and in his book Antiquity of Chamba State, Part 1, published in 1911, by Archaeology Survey of India. After then, Chhabra also covered and deciphered 82 copper plate inscriptions of medieval and late medieval period. As the custom of the issue, such documents was kept up till the end of the last century. Now I am going to introduce this copper plate. This copper plate belonged to Raja Pritam Singh of Chamba and is now kept in the Bhuri Singh Museum. And I had good fortune to examine this copper plate and read its contents on January 2019, with the great cooperation of research assistant of concerned museum. The plate, which is inscribed on single side, is the landscape orientation size of copper plate, about 23.3 cm height by 23.5 cm wide, actually in the handle of its left. The language of the copper plate is partly Sanskrit and partly Chambiali. There are also mentioned some numerals in the inscription, such as 2, 3 and 9. The record is dated is the Shastra Samvat 39, Vikrami Samvat 1722, and which may be held equivalent to 1663 AD. Now I am going to what is the historical importance of this copper plate inscription. This copper plate inscription are most of the significant epigraphical sources of the history of any region and any kingdom. So are the copper plate inscription of Chamba region. Since the published by J.P.S. Fogel and B.C. Chhabra works, many copper plate inscriptions are found in Chamba regions as compared to neighboring region of the Western Himalaya. All copper plate inscriptions are historically significant because these inscriptions have detailed description regarding contemporary rulers, of their polity, detailed descriptions of the rural landscape, and economic detail of other perspective. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
So now we go on to the next advisor. Miss Vinny Vishwakarma. And paper is Indore Beach Rakhada Sanskar.
I'm sorry, sir, I was not following this list.
No, there are a few changes. There are a few changes because split into two redfish sections.
No, sir, I am in this section only, but I don't think you are following
this. We are not simply following that because there are some constraints. That's why I asked, are you in line? You said no.
Yes, sir, I know. I know it asked me, sir.
We are not following the same system. She has booked her ticket, etc. She is
also there is a section. It is divided into two sections.
The table is also divided into two sections. Up to 100 each is here.
Sir, I am under
100. Within 100. That's why I asked,
are you under 100?
After 100, it is the next one. After.
I am here.
Yes. Which is great. So Vinny will start now. You take 4-5 minutes. And you promised 2 minutes, but I am sure he will not respond to 2 minutes. Take 4 minutes. Yes. Right.
Good morning, everyone. मेरा टॉपिक है हिंदुओं के बीच गर्भाधान संस्कार. वैसे तो ये संस्कार सभी जातियों में एक महत्वपूर्ण संस्कार है, लेकिन ये संस्कार जो है श्रेष्ठ संतान उत्पन्न करने के लिए किया जाता था. मध्यकालीन भारत में इस संस्कार के लिए पुरुषों की आयु कम से कम 25 वर्ष और स्त्रियों की आयु को 16 वर्ष माना गया था. अथर्ववेद में भी इस संस्कार के संकेत मिलते हैं, क्योंकि विवाह से स्त्री और पुरुष सर्वथा इस प्रकार से प्रयत्न करते हैं कि दोनों एक दूसरे से कभी भी पृथक रूप से आचरण न करें. राजबली पांडे ने विचार व्यक्त किया है कि संतति प्राप्त करना प्रत्येक व्यक्ति का आवश्यक कर्तव्य समझा जाता था. यह कर्तव्य गर्भाधान से ही संभव था, इसलिए अनेक स्त्रियों को गर्भाधान करने के लिए बुलाया जाता था. अश्विन देवता से गर्भ की रक्षा कर की प्रार्थना करते हुए 10वीं मास में होने वाली संतान को बुलाया गया है. एक अन्य प्रार्थना से भी हमें पता चलता है कि 100 वर्ष के भीतर ही बच्चा पैदा होता है, वो पिता बनता है. इसलिए देवताओं से ये प्रार्थना की गई थी कि इसे नष्ट न किया जाए. गर्भाधान संस्कार के बाद सुख पूर्वक प्रसव के लिए भी देवताओं से प्रार्थना की गई थी कि जब भी बच्चे का जन्म हो वो जीवित ही हो. विष्णु ने गर्भाधान और निश्चय को समानार्थक माना है. इस संस्कार के दिन पति और पत्नी दोनों यज्ञ करते हैं और विशिष्ट मंत्रों का पाठ करते हुए आहुतियां दी जाती हैं. इन मंत्रों में श्रेष्ठ संतान प्राप्ति हेतु परमात्मा से प्रार्थना की जाती है. पुत्र प्राप्ति हेतु ऋतु काल से 6वीं, 8वीं, 10वीं, 12वीं, 14वीं और 16वीं रात्रि में गर्भधान करना चाहिए, जबकि पुत्री की इच्छा होने पर 5वीं, 7वीं, 9वीं और 15वीं रात्रि में गर्भधान का निर्देश है, जबकि 8वीं, 4वीं, 10वीं, अमावस्या और पूर्णमासी की रात्रि को इसे निषेध माना गया है. प्रारंभ से चले आ रहे इस गर्भधान संस्कार का मध्य काल में उल्लेख करते हुए अरब यात्री अलबरूनी ने लिखा है कि ब्राह्मण का यह कर्तव्य है कि वह संतान प्राप्ति के लिए गर्भधान संस्कार करे. गर्भवती स्त्री को कुल का प्रतिष्ठापक समझा जाता था और गर्भ की सुरक्षा की जाती थी. वेनिस संहार में भी द्रौपदी अपने पुत्र वधु उत्तरा के गर्भधान के 4वें मास में सुभद्रा से को उसकी सावधानी पूर्वक रक्षा करने की सलाह देती है. इस अवस्था में स्त्रियों को कई कठिनाइयों का सामना करना पड़ा था, इसलिए उन्होंने अपने पुरुष संबंधियों से सहायता की मांग की थी. यह पति पत्नी का मिलन के बाद होता था और इसमें पत्नियों को अलंकृत रहने की सलाह दी जाती थी. पति पत्नी को आदेश देता था कि गर्भावस्था के समय वो आनंद और प्रसन्नता से रहे और मन को शिव संकल्पों वाला रखे, ताकि वो गर्भधान के बाद बच्चों का पालन पोषण में तत्पर रह सके. परिवार में संतान उत्पत्ति के विषय में अलबरूनी ने लिखा है कि ब्राह्मण का यह कर्तव्य था कि वह संतान उत्पत्ति के लिए अपनी पत्नी के साथ रहे, लेकिन वह शर्म के कारण ऐसा नहीं करता है. इस प्रकार हम पाते हैं कि गर्भधान संस्कार संतान प्राप्ति हेतु पत्नी के साथ संपन्न किया गया एक यज्ञ है, जो पूर्वत की भांति मध्य काल में भी बना रहा, लेकिन लज्जा के वश यह ब्राह्मणों द्वारा नहीं किया जाता.
थैंक यू. इंदिरा इज नॉट देयर.
So I don't mind if it goes line by line. I have that much time, but I
then very thankful to you.
Okay.
This
interview.
Okay. Mr. Nagendra Rao. Hira Nawaz is.
Good morning, Chairperson and delegates. My topic is epigraphic evidence of language, scripts and calligraphy of Sadhana. I divided my paper in three parts: language, scripts and calligraphy. Inscription conveys valuable information besides administrative or provincial nature about the linguistic development during the Sultanate period. Being official documents, the number of Arabic Persian inscriptions increases under the Sultans of Delhi. Thus, the large number of inscriptions recorded in Arabic, Persian and Sanskrit are during the Sultanate period. The recorded epigraphs were written in Persian language of Vedic script, Nasq, Tulat and Nastali and Sanskrit. Muslim immigrants spoke Persian, Arabic language has a special degree of on account of language of religion. The oldest documents in Arabic language dated back to 6th century were two inscriptions and were noted from Haran and Damascus, and three recently discovered inscriptions are found from the Saudi Arabia. Arabic language and script must have been spread throughout the world of Arabia shortly after the Islamic conquest. Arabic as a language introduced to India by the Arabs merchants and commanders in the 8th century. Thus, in the western provinces, Arabic continued to establish till the last quarter of 10th century, when the Turkish ruler, the Ghaznavids and Ghurids introduced Persian as administrative as spoken language. Persian as a language had its ancient incidents and course of time became an official language of Sassanid kings of Persia, which is evident from the inscription engraved on the rock of Persepolis. The Ghaznavids introduced Persian as administrative language, and India followed the Persianized culture, which continued during the Sultanate period. As a result, the Ghaznavid culture produced the first renowned Persian poet Masood Shah Sulman in Lahore and Amir Khusro in Delhi under the Delhi Sultanate. Side by side, Sanskrit being a language of Indian religion and Indian elite class also flourished, and Sanskrit received attention of the Delhi Sultans, as is evident from the Sanskrit inscriptions which has been engraved by the order of Sultans of Delhi. Both Arabic and Persian language brought India by the Muslim invaders. The first epigraph recorded written in both Arabic and Persian, which are found on Qutub Minar and Quwwatul Islam Mosque respectively, but Arabic remained in vogue till the time of Babur. Arabic script developed from the Mediterranean script, which was prevalent in Northern Arabia in pre-Islamic period, sometimes around 608 AD. The early Arabic script was developed in Kufa, a city of Iraq. Thus, the script received its name Kufi. The Kufi is bold, angular, and majestic, and used as on architecture, engraving titles, etc. Kufi is easy to recognize, and that it's angular, using large horizontal and short vertical lines and curves. The first Kufi inscriptions we notice from the Quwwatul Islam Mosque and Qutub Minar on the arm of the Araikara Chopra, which is the first one in Indian subcontinent. The Kufic was replaced by the Nasq, and first Nasq inscriptions we notice from Quwwatul Islam Mosque. The ornamental style of Nasq is called Qut, means one third, and the period from the 14th century onwards is important for the introduction of evolution of Qut, which is evident from the epigraphs belonging to Tughlaq period executed in Nasq letter mark the transition period of Nasq. As soon as Qut script came to be used for historical purpose, the Nasq was kept for the religious texts. By the 14th century, a new script of writing developed, which replaced the earlier Nasq, is Nastali. Nastali is a compound of Arabic script Nasq and Persian script Taliq, is called Nastali. And the first scriptures which is noticed in Nastali are found in the Balban period of the Balban period of Delhi Sultanate. The style of writing of this inscription is Puri's jumble of Nusk and Nastali. The first Nastali record is found from the Balban period, which was popularized in 16th century by the Mughal period of calligraphy. Sanskrit language was also carried out by the Delhi Sultans, which could be evident from their Sanskrit inscriptions in the particular reign. The first Sanskrit epigraphs of the Delhi Sultanate is recorded in Nagarik script notice from Qutub Minar. That this language and its script further carried out by the succeeding rulers of Sultanate period, which is evident from the same monuments Qutub Minar. For example, inscription of Qutubuddin Aibak, Alauddin Khilji, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, Firoz Shah Tughlaq, etc. And the script of calligraphy, I'm coming to also calligraphy, the script of calligraphy is now known as Tughra. The distinct style of this calligraphy rose out of the Arabic writing, to which A.K. Bhattacharya says that the Tughra means an imperial signature on the royal title, prefix the letter. The Tughra is ornamental writing in which the letters are interwoven as to assume the decorative shape, which is difficult to read. Tughra style can be decorated in any shape. It is interesting to note. Yes, sir. It is interesting to note that the earliest inscription in Tughra styles found from the Bihar Sharif during the Balban period. Thus, the Muslim kings of India love to ornament their mosques and tombs with inscriptions consisting of Quranic verses, Hadith, Muslims, Greeks, and moral teaching, etc. Thank you.
Title is Aisala Shivila Queen of Title.
Good morning, Chairperson, Co-Chairpersons, Delegates. I'm Dr. Indira from Usman University. My paper is based on Risala and Daria. It is a manuscript. It's a manuscript compiled by Mir Momin Astrabadi, who was an Iranian of Afghan. He migrated to Qutub Sahib period Golconda, Deccan, during the period of Qutub Sahib, so in 16th century. Here we see that Mir Momin Al-Husayni Astrabadi, he penned down the Risala-e-Miqdariya during 1625. It is a treatise on weights and measures compiled by him. He was the Peshwa, he was the philanthropist. He was very much took part in town planning Hyderabad. He himself gave the name as Ispanello to Hyderabad. So Hyderabad is given by him. He belongs to Astrabad village in Iran. So there we see these manuscripts. Script is available in Salarjung Museum, Hyderabad. Manuscript number 127, Kitla. And this is of 17 pages manuscript. It is divided into three chapters. So we see...
chapters or divisions?
Chapters.
We have to wait for the finishing.
This is an article.
It's an article?
Yeah.
Brief and
present. Yeah, yeah.
It is the one.
Chapters. I was afraid that
so it is divided into three chapters. Mukhadame, that is the preface, then part of the measurements part, and Khatima, that is conclusion. So in the preface we see that he has given on about the Muhammad Kuli Qutub Shah, as he was telling The manuscript was endorsed by this that Darazan Tasnif Mir Momin Peshwa Rahmatullah while Nuskaya Mutabarik Bakhtar Mursanif Ast. It means that measurements measured by Mir Momin Peshwa Rahmatullah, that this was the authentic codex written by him after doing much research. So what are these 12 standard measures of Risale-i-Miqdariya? So this Risale-i-Miqdariya of 12 standards divided into 12 chapters, and each chapter is telling about each measurement with authentic research and the appropriate weights. So the 12 standard measures are Habba. Habba weight is equal to 1 jaw 1 oat. Tasu weight 2 jaw, that is 2 oats. Hirat weight 4 jaw, 4 oats. Danik, dang, 8 jaw. Dirham, 48 jaw, 48 oats. Mishkal weight, 68 jaw, 68 oats. Istar weight, 4.5 mishkal. Okia, Ratal, 1, Khelja, Maku. These are the 12 standard weights which we see in the works, and still in Hyderabad we see these names are still, many of the names are existing. In the second part of the chapter, he mentioned about the distances of roads. It is measured in like 10 furlong is equal to 1 mile. So we see it is still in Hyderabad, we see this 8 furlong, 2 furlong is used. So still they are writing of Mir Momin Hyderabadi Risale-i-Miqdariya. These words are still used in Hyderabad. And the third chapter is with consist of weights like Mashat, 8 Maap. 8 Maap we still continue in telling. 8 Maap is equal to like glass vessel. So it's no. Like, so the last pages of manuscripts on page number 13-14 he has told about that this is the authentic work, and he wrote Mohare Suleiman Zak Gast Mayasar Mera. So he declared that this book is the authentic work. So I would like to say that Mir Risale-i-Miqdariya in Persian language is one of the major important works which was done during the Qutub Shahi period, Golconda Deccan. It is because there was Islamic jurisprudence. According to the Islamic jurisprudence, there were no authentic weights during that time. So Hyderabadi has done an excellent work to bring about the authentic measurements. Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you.
My paper is on a good morning, my name is Rafia. My paper is on a class in the British Sultanate. This was known by the name of the Amirani Sada, and this is basically, we know about this class during the Tughlaq period from three important texts of that period. One of them is Balni, another is Sami, and yet another is Batinta. These three texts refer to this community of people who are known as the Amirani Sada, and who were important because they caused a number of rebellion during the 14th century in regions like Dhar, Malwa and Gujarat. So
The important thing about these rebellions and the people who caused this rebellion is that it is basically argued, like even in texts like Andrew Ring, and even in earlier texts like K.N. Nizami's very important legendary work on the Delhi Sultanate, it is usually argued that these are people who are basically referred to as riffraff, people who did not really have a standing, who were recent migrants and who came and who just rebelled. And joined with whoever was in power. However, if you look at the three of these rebellions and you look at the people who actually caused these rebellions, you see that they were people who are importantly A, not riffraff. Secondly, they are people who had a lot of experience in living in the provinces of the Delhi Sultanate. So they are not people who reside in the capital. They do not.